Today is Thursday, June 21st. It's 10:05 a.m. My understanding is that we do have a quorum of the commission. Thank you, everybody, for being here. Notice of the meeting has been publicly posted. Minutes from the last meeting 2 weeks ago have been sent to all the commission members. At this time, I would ask if there are any additions or subtractions. Hearing none, the minutes were not sent out. At this point, we will withdraw the previously stated minutes being distributed. Thank you, Deputy Clerk. Usually they are, they're supposed to be. But anyhow, we do have some cleanups from the last couple meetings where, and it should all be in front of you with the proposals from parts A and B that either we discussed and held the vote on for, in order to get it in front of everybody in some kind of order. But all of the proposals from A and B, the commission heard discussion and agreed to make the proposal, right? But we did not call the vote because the language was still fluctuating, and we asked Rachel to clean that all up, and she has, and it would be the last two paper clips in your packet, Part A, Chapters 1 and 11. I'd like to clean up as much as we can from previous meetings before we move into Part C, unless there is an objection or a better course of doing business. I'm always open to it. Hearing none. So from Part A, we did discuss proposal number two to amend 76-1 to have the planning director serve at the pleasure of the mayor without nomination by the commission for appointment or concurrence of commission for removal, and to have the planning director be the appointing authority for the commission staff rather than the commission. As we all recall, that's how it happens. It's just the charter reads differently. And any further discussion or questions on that proposal? Hearing none, I would call the question. Alan, Deputy Clerk? Yes.
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 Thank you, Deputy Clerk. I'm just going to call him Alan. Thanks, Alan. on the flip side of that page, proposal number three was to amend section 76-6 to add that the mayor shall appoint two alternate members to the BZA. As we had the chairwoman here, we know that quorum sometimes becomes an issue. The payment of alternates is not considered in the proposal, but certainly we have had discussion. We serve in place of the member of the board. Right, but really the in-application to the commission, we'll leave that to the BZA if they want to have the alternates there, or like the Planning Commission does, they have two in the bullpen, and hopefully the day before they call them and say, hey, can you be here tomorrow? We got a quorum issue. And if they appear, then they would be compensated. But if they don't appear, at least we're kind of leaving that up to the administration, because the BZA sometimes has hearings that goes on for a couple of weeks, or they'll kick it to another date. So if that alternate is at one or not at one, we want them to be fully informed before they vote on the issue. So that was really hard to put in a charter amendment, so we came up with the best language we could. And any questions on proposal number three regarding the alternates for the BZA? Hearing none, Alan, I'll call the question.
Okay. Yes.
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 Very good. Thank you. Proposal number four in the same packet. To amend section 76-6 to add a 30-day time frame during which the city must post and fill vacancies on the BZA.
What question?
McDade.
Should this be limited to just BZA, or should we look, or should we consider all the boards? Knowing what we've...
Yeah, we definitely talked about that. Rachel?
Yeah, we did talk about that. I think it might be easier because there are so many boards and commissions in the code, not the charter. It might be easier to do that in the code, in the codified ordinances, as opposed to the charter. The charter has specific, and then we could do them individually in the charter. And that's just my thought for that.
Right.
The ones that are in the charter, you put that timeframe within the charter itself.
And also, is 30 days enough? As we talked about extensively, was, you know, how important of a position it is and how you need to find the right person that doesn't have an agenda? You know what I mean? But 30 days is where the discussion ended. We know that the filling of vacancies is crucial, and it's pertinent to the charter, but specific to the administration, because council doesn't really have appointments. We approve it through the mayor's appointment committee, right? But that's just after submission by the administration?
Yeah, they submit it, and then we...
They select,
right,
screen, and submit it to the committee you chair.
Right.
And then you hear it.
Right.
Right.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, council.
Okay. So, Mr. Chairman, I served on the Board of Zoning Appeals for 6 years. I don't think 30 days is enough time to find a suitable, you know, it's a five-year term, replacement. You know, I mean, you would have to have...
Well, the hope is, Councilwoman, because we just passed the alternates. So
yeah.
The alternate is that the alternates had been serving and not sitting, but they had an interest in it. So there had already been some screening and gauging of interest. Mm-hmm. And so...
Well, that's the hope.
Right. I mean, that's where our discussion took us is, you know, is 30 days enough? Well, it sure is if you have two alternates that have been paying attention and showing up.
Maybe.
Then you have a already pre-screened pool of candidates who are willing to serve. Yeah, no, I agree completely. That was my, but I don't know what to make a recommendation, and the commission will hear it out. 60? 90?
At least 60. At least 60. Because the alternate can serve for those 60 days or 90 days. You know, there's never been, I mean, we've had vacancies infinitum up there sometimes, finding the right person. So, I mean, it's a good thing about the alternates, and yes, you do have them, but, you know, we can't be sure that if there's one alternate, that's going to be the person that people are, that you know, satisfies the board and the constituency and the mayor. So a minimum of 60 or even 90, because what's the difference? I mean, you know, if you have somebody to serve interim.
Right.
But under that circumstance, you're assuming that we have the two alternates.
Right.
Right. I know what we just went through trying to fill boards and finding people and everything. So the 60 or 90 days would be good if we knew that there was always going to be those two alternates there. We don't know, just because we give the authority to appoint two alternates, we're not necessarily guaranteed the two alternates are going to be sitting there. In the meantime, if you only have that 30 days, what if there's no alternates already sitting in place?
So what if they don't want to commit?
Or they don't want to commit. This, I think the 30 days then puts the pressure on the powers to be to find that right person. And not hold up BZA.
Right.
If that makes...
Mr. Chairman, I would say
our organization is often in front of the BZA almost every week, right? So it's a very important committee to us, and there are a lot of issues to discuss in the committee, and there have been several times where it has been bare bones. There have been times where we've had, you know, everyone kind of standing around looking, waiting to find out if there was going to be quorum to hear the business that was to be discussed that day. I do agree that I think it is extraordinarily important and that there needs to be ample time to find the right person to serve on that, and therefore I think 60 days makes sense to allow for that. 90 days is a long time. That is 3 months. And so you look at the agendas that come through BZA, I mean, it is dozen plus items every single week that are really important. And so I agree that we need to hold the administration's feet to the fire to quickly move through that process. I think 30 days can be a little tight. You know, 4 weeks to go out and find the right person seems like that is a really difficult chore, but 60 seems very reasonable, and it makes sure that they're committed to doing so.
I just want to mention that the 30 days is just for posting the announcement of the vacancy. This isn't but the time in which you have to choose.
Post and
choose.
Fill.
It's for posting the vacancy within 30 days. Yeah.
Well then.
So this is a little different.
Is there a time limit then for appointment?
There isn't.
No. Not in here.
Well, that makes no sense.
Can we shorten the time frame for posting?
Yeah.
that doesn't make sense. You know. Well,
oh, I see.
I'm
so
not going to go into the
30-day
real
time frame during which the city must post and fill vacancies on the BZA, but the underlined amendment is just post.
Gotcha.
This is the exact language that was amended into the police review board language in the charter. So that's where this language came from.
Yeah, but on the police review board, I mean, that right now they've got some serious business to do because they've got to adhere to the DOJ report, right? So,
wait a minute.
It does say
post and fill.
In the proposal on the top, but the underlying section below the actual language of the amendment, it says, shall post an announcement of any vacancy and a request for applications to fill any vacancy. Members shall be chosen from the applicants without a time frame. But the bold proposal on the top does say post and fill. That's a typo. So it's consistent with the police review board. They got to post it in a timely manner and to accept applications, but the time frame for filling is not in this amendment being considered today,
which I think is the concern.
Okay.
Right.
Do we have that language? Do we have the authority to add that language?
We have the authority to do anything. I think what I would do is either this is just the posting, not the filling.
Mm-hmm.
We can amend it to 60 days post and fill.
Yeah.
And again, this is a recommendation to the council for consideration.
I mean,
if that's the will of the commission, I don't, it seems like a tight window. But again, my history is vacancies for a very long time. I don't particularly like it always, but.
So within 60 days of any vacancy, including the vacancies caused by the end of the term, the city shall post an announcement of the vacancy, request for applications, request for applications, and shall fill the vacancy. I'll add that. You want it to be 60 days.
You can do post within 30, fill within 60.
Yep.
Post within 30 and fill within 60.
Yeah. Well, if you post, is there a point in making this distinction?
That's right. That's right. Post within 30 and fill within 60. That's right.
But then we're back to the original 30 days to fill.
Right.
You know what I mean? So
unless it's you're taking a whole 90 days as your time period, first 30 posting,
you know what I mean?
Then 60 to fill.
Post and
or what
fill
if you do post in like a shorter time frame than 30?
It shouldn't take 30 days.
Post.
Seven days
to post.
Right,
and
but I think the language is allow the posting to be open
broadcast
for 30 days. Right, so if not everybody will know when the term ends, so you post it to let a greater population know that there's a vacancy and that the city's taking application, and then you close it after 30 days, and then you have whatever we're talking about today, either 30 or 60 days to fill that vacancy. Because we want to leave the posting open.
A question, I don't know nothing about this on purpose. So you have to apply, I thought that we were seeking for people, but there's an application process?
Well, you have to, there's not a formal application, like a job application, but your resume, you get interviewed. There's screenings that happen to be a member of the BZA, yes.
What?
They don't go look for you, you gotta, I mean, where do they post this at? How do they, I mean, they put it on the website where you post a job, like?
Right.
What we've done for the police review board is we've posted it on the website. We've also sent out a press release saying that it's available and that people apply. And I think there's no strict application, but folks can do whatever they want.
Right.
You know, resumes, cover letter, that kind of thing is submitted, and then the person is chosen from those applicants.
But not like a job application?
No, no.
So I think the tenor of the commission may be 30 days posting, 60 days to fill the vacancy, which would
be a 90-day total time frame.
Would be a 90-day total time frame, Rachel?
I mean, you're only talking.
Mr. Chairman, you're only talking about one meeting a week. It's not like a full-time job. So even if it's 60 days, it's only 8 meetings. So you've got alternates, one or two alternates, if that's approved. So I think that we would be good.
It's still a big commitment. I mean, if you have, especially if you have a full-time job with a boss who's saying you're gone every Friday for however long. Sometimes they go till
Mondays.
Sometimes, or Mondays, right?
Sometimes till noon, 1 o'clock.
Right.
Yep.
It's substantial. But you're absolutely right. And I think 30 days to post, 60 days to consider, and hopefully fill that vacancy is
And so this is 60 additional days. So 30 days to post, and then after the 30 days, the 60 days starts. Okay.
Weren't we saying 90 days total was too long, though, originally? So we're kind of...
We did when we... Yeah. But I think the discussion, that was when we were thinking post and fill, but we went back to the 30 days of just posting, 60 days to consider the candidates for filling the vacancy. And I think it's longer than the original discussion was, but once you get into the whole posting and finding the best candidate, at least I think it's a reasonable amount of time. But it's up to us. I mean, if we put it at 60, then you have 30 days to post, 30 days to pick. And that's...
Mr. Chair, I actually understand most of that. I think the one part that I'm having a hard time getting my arms around is 30 days just to post a job vacancy. That is a long time to give somebody to just simply start the advertising process. I think 30 days makes sense for the advertising process because you want to cast as wide a net as you can. But I think Councilman Casey said possibly 7 days. I mean, it seems like a reasonable that within a week of somebody leaving to just get the post out there because that will tighten up the rest of the entire process and timeline.
I mean, instead of putting a cap on when posting has to be done, what if you were just to say, back to the original thing, 60 days to post and fill? I'm 90 days to post and fill. Take the whole time period, 90 days to post and fill.
Yeah.
And Mr. Chair, the other thing is that anyone who's interested in the Board of Zoning Appeals knows when someone's term is about to expire, and automatically, if they're that interested, sends a letter to the mayor with their resume. I mean, that's just the way.
Yeah, but that might not be the person who does.
Right. Well,
it, finding somebody who's that invested in it.
Well,
we're looking
it
for a
may
broad
not
range
be,
of,
but
of representation.
But I think that, you know, either way, you know, 30 days to post gives everybody the opportunity to, you know, find, I mean, if you don't find it out by then, and if it's on the website and everything else, then should be able to choose between those people in 30 days, I think, so.
Right. Yeah, I
so 30 and 30
is,
would be my.
Anything we do is a drastic change to the current way they do it. So I guess I'm leaning towards what the director said with the 90 days post and fill, and leave the other benchmarks criteria up to the administration. Because, you know, we could say post immediately for 30 days, and then you have 60 days to consider applications and fill it on the, you know, 91st day. In application, it just doesn't work that way. So I'm trying to be as flexible as possible while still making a dramatic, what I think would be a benefit to the board. Did you have something, Nick?
No, I mean, that's fair.
So the current proposal for consideration by the commission is 90 days to post and fill a vacancy with the Board of Zoning Appeals. Without further discussion, I would call the question. Alan? Yes.
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 Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes.
No.
Marty? Yes.
Yes.
Director?
This is on something else.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, no, I have to apologize for being late. I had another commitment first thing this morning. But I understand you already considered proposal number 2. And I just wanted to recommend a language change, just because we don't use the term at the pleasure anywhere else in the charter. When we appoint directors, it's under the mayor's appointing power as stated in Charter Section 70. And I think just from a drafting standpoint, so there's no, sometimes when you introduce terms you don't use anywhere else, it causes confusion.
Right.
And so I was just going to recommend that the shall be appointed under the mayor's appointing power as stated in this charter, okay, if that's acceptable to everyone as a wording. That way there's no confusion that it's the same as the appointment of every other director.
Consistency is important.
Thank you.
And I would consider that it's non-substantive amendment to the already voted on proposal, so I wouldn't call the roll unless there is objection or further discussion. Getting rid of at the pleasure of and adding in accordance with the powers. Thank you. Proposal Part B, Chapter 3, Proposal Number 5, to amend Section 7 to require that candidates use a statewide standard candidacy and nominating petition form from the Secretary of State instead of the City of Cleveland petition form. Long discussion on this one. Any further questions, additions, subtractions? I think we all have a pretty firm handle on Councilman McCormick's plight in the last election, where he was brought out on Front Street.
More contact with the voters.
That's right. Very important. I would call the question. Alan? Yes.
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 Thank you. And as in the same vein, proposal number 6, again, the language of the Secretary of State instead of the City of Cleveland, but then to further amend Section 7 to clarify that a candidate is not required to have a designated committee of petitioners under this chapter. So in the state petition that was shared, there was a section for a committee. It's not required, nobody does it, but the Secretary of State has it on there. So it was the will of the commission to specifically state in the charter that you don't have to do it. Discussion? I call the question. Alan? Yes.
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 Thank you. So that takes us to Proposal 7, which is to amend Section 18. What was this one, Rachel? Oh, where'd Rachel go? Certified recall petition is considered received by a person whose removal is sought on the date the person whose removal is sought is personally served with notice of the recall, or on the date the notice of the recall is left at the usual place of residence of the person whose removal is sought. Director, do you remember this one?
Yes. I think this is a clarification. In the current Section 18, it says, if a recall petition or amended petition shall be certified by the clerk to be sufficient, he shall at once submit it to council with his certificate and shall notify the person whose removal is sought if the person whose removal is sought does not resign within 5 days. There's no time period, or there's no indication of when that notification starts or how it's done. And so the discussion was, if we said personal notification or leaving it there, their usual residence, that's when the 5 day starts.
Okay. Oh, I remember.
If we consider this, I would want to correct, there's still some gender specific language in there. In the second line, it's sufficient he, I would recommend the clerk, and shall at once submit it to the council with, I would say, a certificate to that effect rather than his certificate.
Very good. Shall be certified by the clerk to be sufficient. The clerk shall at once submit to the council with a certificate by the clerk to be sufficient. I think we just take out he.
They.
They shall at once submit, right? Because the clerk, yeah.
The number difference bothers me. I mean, you can just say, if a recall petition or amended petition shall be certified by the clerk to be sufficient, the clerk shall at once submit it to the council with a certificate to that effect and shall notify the person whose removal is sought. Notice is deemed effective.
Makes perfect sense to me. Any further discussion on proposal number 7? Hearing none, I'll call the question. Yes.
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 Thank you. Part B, proposal deferred for review at June 21 commission meeting. Number 8, amend section 23 to extend the time period during which recall petitions cannot be filed against the mayor or a member of council after taking office from 3 months to 12 months and after a recall election from 6 months to 12 months. And again, this was fully discussed about a elected representative winning an election, getting sworn in, having 1 year to either mess up or do their job, and then 2 year period of recall, and then obviously out of just efficiency sake, a recall within 12 months of an election it doesn't serve any purpose because you're basically facing a recall every 4 years anyhow. Any further discussion on that proposal number 8? Hearing none, call the question. Yes.
Yes.
No.
Yes.
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 No.
Thank you. Now we move on to new proposals, Part B, elections, which is what was paper-clipped in your packet, I think the last packet. Amend Section 5 to provide that an elector of the city, in order to be a candidate for office in the city, must have been a resident of the city for at least 12 months prior to the next municipal election, at which the candidate desires to run for office. The next municipal election at which the candidate desires to run for office. Everybody got it? You know where we are, and we are joined by the council president, who we had some long discussions about these proposals. And did you want to weigh in on this one, Mr. President?
Yes, Mr. Chair, if I can.
Absolutely.
We bat around the idea of residency requirements for elections at the last Charter Review Commission, and we spent a lot of time on it. And what we focus a lot on is whether, you know, any state representative or state senator or office for the state, you have to live in the district that you intend to run for a year prior to that election. So there was a lot of talk, you know, you should have to live in the ward for a year before you run. Where it ultimately failed is that the city of Cleveland is small enough and the line boundaries change frequently enough that the danger would be that if there's an activist that is kind of gearing up to run for council, and we change the ward boundaries every 10 years pursuant to the census, it would be too easy to draw lines around this activist that was gearing up for a particular run. And it would just be seen, because people move, you know, from street to street, you know, neighborhood to neighborhood, it was seen as we just basically scrapped the idea of having a ward-based residency. However, the thing that we never took any action on was just the notion that should you at least live in the city of Cleveland for a full year prior to seeking a city office? And we've had situations where people with substantial, you know, bank accounts or all could move into a certain area for the purpose of running, having not lived here before. 1 year is a designation of time that is very common. It's used by the state, and it's not onerous, and it does not put a chilling effect on anybody who may run for council. Perhaps where I live in Ward 13, the boundary line, you know, Schaff Road, there's very similar neighborhoods on both sides of Schaff. One's in Ward 12, one's in Ward 13. So we don't want to, if somebody lives, like, moves in the old Brooklyn neighborhood, which is, you know, common neighborhood, we don't want to say, you can't run for this. We want to make sure that that's as open as possible. And if somebody wants to, the issue of you don't live in the ward, that becomes a political question. That becomes something for your opponents to make fodder of. But it would just, we, at the last charter, and for those of you that were on it, you can kind of opine if my memory is correct, we scrapped the idea of a residence requirements for ward and never executed on the larger citywide. I think that 1 year for citywide would be, you know, in line with what the state does. It would be appropriate, and it would at least show some, it would show some connection to the city, and it would prevent that, you know, person of a certain bank account that could move in and run for an election. So I think it's modest and fair, and doesn't put a chilling effect on people that might run for council.
Great, thank you. And it is 12 months prior to the next municipal election, and I know we talked about it, and it was talked about at the last. So if the election is the you know, not the primary, but the general election,
yeah,
in November,
mm-hmm,
so that person would have to have been a resident
just of the city,
November,
yeah,
of the city anywhere. So it has no effect on anything other than we want people invested in the city, yeah, of Cleveland representing the city of Cleveland.
Yeah, and quite frankly, that's not that hard to do if you're
right,
if you're gearing up for something like that. You know, you're not
here,
that onerous. Yeah,
sure.
It would help.
Yeah, no, I had actually a comment on that. I wanted to make sure that everyone was aware that municipal election means the general election under,
right,
Charter Section 3, and I was wondering why it wasn't the primary, which is held the second Tuesday in September prior to the regular municipal election.
Because I know we know when the primary is, but is the primary, yeah, in Section 3?
No, it's in Section 4.
In 4? Okay.
Yes, it says candidates for all offices to be voted for any regular municipal election shall be nominated at a nonpartisan primary election to be held on the second Tuesday in September prior to the regular municipal election. So we know when the primary is.
And Mr. Chair?
Yes.
That's fine. I don't have any objection to that. This was just because this is what the state requires. But the state's primaries are often, you know, either March or May for November, where ours are 75 days prior, so it's a closer time window. However the commission decides,
right,
I think that's fine. I just think that having something on our charter of some requirement.
You keep grabbing your mic.
Sorry.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Councilman.
Can I get a clarification on elector? Is an elector someone who is registered and has voted in an election a year prior, or someone who is
Rachel,
a resident and registered.
I know it's in there somewhere.
I've always thought elector meant that you were a registered voter.
Yes.
And had voted.
I don't think there's a voting requirement. You have
not
to
a
be,
voting requirement.
You have to be a registered voter.
Just a registered voter, so.
In the city of Cleveland
so,
for 1 year prior.
So they have to have lived in the city of Cleveland and registered to vote a year prior.
Correct.
Okay. I just wanted to clarify that.
And have voted?
No.
Or not just be a registered
voter? We can't.
Require somebody to vote.
Because you can't.
Yeah,
you can't. I mean, depending like this year, next year. Next year, we only have one election in November. It's just judges. It's a plurality election. So that makes it different, you know, than other years. And like you said, you know, well, these are municipal elections, so it doesn't pertain to the state or the federal.
Right.
All right.
Thank you. So the discussion, I don't have any. Yes, Councilman Johnson. One year before the election. Before how it reads now is before the next. Yeah. So if the election was November of 2017, he or she would have had to have been a registered voter of the city of Cleveland before November of 2016. Further discussion?
I have a question.
Yes, Councilwoman.
Chair, is this different than running for a ward? Like, is the ward in the city, if you're running for a city council person, do you have to live within your ward?
You don't.
You don't?
No. And that's what the council president, so it was a long discussion in 2008. A lot of energy went into it. And, you know, the common sentiment was that we don't want to discourage anybody to run who's a city, who loves the city of Cleveland, right? So, and our ward boundaries change, and if you further politicize it and require ward residency, then when we go through the Census Bureau, things could happen, or the census redistricting, things could happen that wouldn't sit well with responsible people.
Okay. It's just, in my opinion, it's hard. You shouldn't be running in a ward that you have no idea what's going on in that
agree
ward.
Agree completely.
And
but right, I know. But I think it would just get in the discussion from 2008 and even today was, it would just further complicate. That is more of a political issue for a campaign,
mm-hmm.
right, than it is for our charter. It was kind of the overarching sentiment.
Got it.
I will, did you have something, Council?
We're good.
You're good? Director, yes?
The language here with the elector and 12 months, isn't there a way to kind of clean it up a little bit as if you have to be a registered voter within Cleveland, as opposed to living here for 12 months, it's kind of a moot point. You have to live in Cleveland to be a registered voter in Cleveland. So, yeah, so since you have to, so it's almost if you're elector for, or you are an elector for 12 months, a minimum of 12 months. So we don't need to address the residency part of it. We're just adding language that doesn't need to be there.
So, Jennifer,
are you saying that?
So he's basically saying that, and has been an elector in the city for at least 12 months.
There. We don't need to address residency.
Right. Yeah. It's redundant.
Yeah.
So is what we're saying, you have to be a registered voter to run?
The city of Cleveland for 12 months to run.
So you have to be a registered voter in order to run for office.
And currently it says that.
Yeah, I'm just clearing up what he...
Take scratching words that don't need to be there.
Sure, sure.
So...
Councilman.
Elector of the city of Cleveland, you are that.
It says elector.
Right, but what?
Just but as the an elector.
Lieutenant, correct me. Must have been a resident of the city. Is that what you're saying is redundant?
Yeah, that if we add language about being a resident of the city, it's the same as them being an elector. So there's no need for that additional language.
I see what you're saying.
Mr. Chair.
Yes, Councilman.
As a point of clarification on this, and forgive my ignorance, in order to register to vote, you must be currently, presently occupying apartment, house, whatever, in that area, correct? You have to sign that you are
legal domicile.
It can't be in 2 weeks I'm moving in and here, it's okay.
Correct.
So for the record, okay.
Yeah. Yeah, I see the redundancy, but I also kind of concur that that's what we want, right? We want them to know that you got to live here to represent them. I agree with your point, but further want to amplify that we want people to live here and seek public office. I think that's why it's redundant.
Actually,
for the elector of the city, in order to be
What I think would clarify that is if you say, and the elector has been an elector of the city for at least 12 months. That doesn't address your continuous thing, but that addresses that they've been registered to vote for 12 months, if that's what you're going towards. Because the way it words now, way it says, and the elector has been a resident, you could be a resident and then register to vote a month before the election. It depends on what you want. But Mr. Hamm is right. I mean, if it's an elector of the city for 12 months, that means the person has to be registered to vote in the city of Cleveland with their primary domicile in the city of Cleveland for 12 months. You know, do you want the qualification that they just live here for 12 months or that they be registered to vote for 12 months and live here? And that's, I would advocate that they be registered to vote because that's a way to prove residency for 12 months, right? Because there's a record at the Board of Elections that they registered to vote 12 months before.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Councilman.
Where does it say domicile?
It doesn't, but that's,
well, I think
registered, that's how you register to vote. You're at your legal domicile.
Yeah, but wait a minute. We have all heard of those people who just get an address, really live somewhere else, that's their domicile, they just get an address in the city of Cleveland. So, but you know, if you put domicile in there, we know what domicile means. It's actually got a definition. It's where, you know, you intend to live, you're always coming back, you pay your car insurance, you pay, you know, rent insurance, it's where your clothes are. I mean, it's, you know, it's different than, I think we don't want to leave it open to somebody that just gets an apartment and registers to vote there.
Yeah, I don't think we're ever going to charter our way around that. I mean, that's why the Board of Elections has
challenges. But the word domicile is not in here.
And I don't think it should be because that's an Ohio Revised Code definition, which you would challenge through the Board of Election on somebody's registration to vote, not necessarily a charter prohibition to, again, we're not trying to prohibit anybody from running. We're trying to encourage people to run, but we want people who live here to run for 1 year. I think the further domicile or where you sleep every night. I mean, we could put anything we want in there, but what would be your, how would you challenge somebody? You didn't sleep there last night. That's the Board of Elections.
Does it be wood sometimes? Tickle sometimes?
Does anybody have a recommendation?
Soling sometimes? It depends.
Reverend.
No comment.
Okay, so I think we need to clean this up to show the consecutive 12 months, show the registration to vote in the city of Cleveland for the 12 months prior, and eliminate some of the redundancies or duplicative language. Rachel, can we take another shot at this one?
Yes, sir.
You're the best.
Is it still on the table to have the 12 months run from the primary or from the general election?
Yeah, I think I'd leave, if we could write that up both ways, simply from the next municipal election or the next primary election as illuminated in section 4. I think we'll call that question first at the next meeting, if that's all right with everybody. I'd like a clean copy of this written both ways.
Okay, two proposals,
if that's okay. And then we're going to... And anybody who has a comment on section 5 or additional consideration,
Mr. Chairman,
please email Rachel. Yes?
One more thing on the residency. In the event of a vacancy that occurs within that 12 months, what happens?
Filling of vacancies on council is on, we already did that.
No, I know that. No, what happens about the 12-month residency if there's a vacancy sooner than, let's say, if there's a vacancy 6 months for a special election?
I think it would be the same. So a vacancy on a sitting council seat, and then you have to fill it. Anybody who wants to run in that special election has to be an elector of the city of Cleveland for the consecutive, for 12 months.
So it'd be no change?
No, this doesn't cover
okay.
it.
Because that would still, under section 3, be the next municipal election.
Okay.
Yeah. Regular municipal election is a defined term, and it's only the November election every 4 years. The change to 5 would not cover folks' qualifications to run for a vacancy.
This doesn't say the regular. It says the next municipal election, which I just took to mean a citywide election. So if there was a ward-wide, not regularly.
Wait, I'm sorry, where is...
It should say regular municipal election.
Oh, it should.
Yes, it should.
Yeah.
Which then would not apply to the vacancy.
That's correct. Regular municipal election is defined in section 3 as
right.
the election every 4 years,
right.
the general election every 4 years.
Oh, I thought it intentionally said next municipal election to
that
get away from the regular. It was an unintentional.
Next municipal election. That regular municipal election
you guys.
Means the
right.
every 4 year election in November.
Okay.
And so what you would have to do is either change the part on appointments
filling
vacancies.
Vacancies
or change qualifications for candidates, where it has qualifications for council candidates. Section 26.
Yeah, and we're actually looking at those later today.
We're coming up on that
yeah.
in this section, qualifications.
Because then if you made it a qualification that a person has to be an elector for 12 months before any election for which they're elected,
Right.
Then
any municipal
election.
Any city
election, exactly. Then they, there's a possibility they could be appointed and not qualify, but they never could run.
Right.
Oh. So how does that affect that?
How does what affect what?
An appointment.
Well, if you appoint somebody who doesn't live in the ward or hasn't been there
for
a year,
then
they
could
run.
They have to live in the city.
Or the city, yeah. Right.
So that, yeah.
Yeah, I don't.
No, that.
They just couldn't run. Right.
Yeah.
Right. Why would you appoint them? Yes, Council.
But they couldn't serve.
That's state law. Right. Right, and I think what we're hoping that Rachel's going to clarify in the two differing proposals is consecutive or language about being a registered voter in the city of Cleveland for the 12 months prior to, right? I don't think we're ever going to stop the possibility of somebody renting an apartment, registering to vote, and then going back to their house in Bratnall or somewhere else, right? But that's where you would challenge it through the state law and the Board of Elections. I don't think we can get that far down the rabbit hole in our charter to put it to the voters, is my personal opinion. But I'm just one vote on this commission. Yeah, I think what we're going to do is again, we're going to get clarifying language on this proposal. We're going to look at the qualifications for candidacy later on in this hearing, and we can continue the discussion at that point without objection. We are moving on to proposal to amend section 17, require that a recall petition have signatures of 20% of those who voted in 50% of the precincts in the city or ward respectively at the last municipal election. Talked about this extensively at the last hearing. Afterwards, there was a lot of discussion about how do we get it reflective of the entire ward. How do, you know, our wards are bigger with unique neighborhoods, and how do you make sure that a recall petition is reflective of the will of the people? And this is a proposal for discussion today, and I know Council President and I had some long discussions about this, and there's some state law that's applicable that you are aware of. Mr.
Yes.
President?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I want to just kind of start by saying that I'm aware of the discussion that was held last commission, and that there's a comfort level in the 20%. So
right.
that's good. That's been the law. So I'm not seeking to do that. But what I want to ask the commission to consider is that voting and elections are pretty sacred things, and we've had one election that was won by single digits. We have two that were, you know, one that was under 20, and we've had a whole bunch that were under 100. So I guess the what I want to prevent is that while 20%, you know, is a number that we've used, I want to be cautious of the fact that, take for example for mayor, you could get your almost 20% of your signatures in Ward 1 and 4. And it's not necessarily representative of all those people that voted for the mayor. Similarly, in a ward, you know, there's little pockets of different wards. You could get your 20% from a small, like one or two precincts to trigger a recall. And the question is that equitable or representative of the body of the people that voted, whether it's the city or the ward? So there's no recall at the state level. So the closest thing that I thought was applicable, or something I would ask the commission to consider, is that when you're doing an initiative petition for the state, you can't just get all your signatures from Cuyahoga County, and you can't just get all your signatures from Mahoning County. You have to get your signatures from 44 of the 88 counties if you're doing something statewide. So I guess if I'm going in three parts, I want to say check. I heard the commission's discussion about 20%, so check. We're going to keep that. So that's issue one. Issue two is in getting your 20%, I would recommend that at least 50% of the precincts, just like 50% of the counties are required for the state, 50% of the precincts be represented in signing off on that petition. So it's not just a small number. So that's issue two. Now, follow me here for just a second, because this need not be confusing, but in our discussions, it ended up being confusing. At the state level, for your 44 counties, their requirement is 10%, but to count, you have to have 5% of that county voting, okay? So where we have 20%, I'm suggesting that to be half the precincts, it should be half of that number. 10% should come from those precincts to count. Did I lose everybody? Okay.
10% from 50% of the precincts.
Yes.
So one half of the requirement from one half of the precincts in the ward.
Yes.
Is the requirement.
Right. With the goal being that we do not want to do anything. We want to make sure that this right that citizens have is there, but we also want to make sure that it's representative of a broad, you know, those that elected people. I mean, you know, elections are, you know, it's a great thing that we have. People go through a lot, and a lot of elections are very close. So if a candidate got 49% of the vote, certainly you could easily find 20 that may want to, you know, petition for recall. So the question is, yes, you have that right, but make sure that it's not just based on, you know, where I live. You know, if I lost, and I shouldn't be able to get all my signatures from precinct 13A, where my neighbors live. and some of them like me. So I shouldn't be able to get all of my votes there. I should have to get my signatures from at least one half of the precincts in Ward 13 to take out the person that defeated me, is the thought.
And the same argument for the mayor.
Yeah, same argument
instead
for the mayor.
Instead of going just to Ward 1 and 17 or
right.
Ward 3.
Because that would be...
You need to get more than half of the wards, mm-hmm. which would be 9 wards,
yeah.
10% of 20% of the people who voted in the last mayoral election. So, yeah, I got it. Questions? Comments? Concerns? Councilman?
I agree with you.